that's basically what the Finnish government decided to showcase as their move for the future. And they're doing it. Like in Helsinki right now, there's over 3,000 startups. They have the highest number of startups in the world for the simple reason that the iPhone killed Nokia. Nokia was the number one cell phone manufacturer in the world, and all the engineers are basically all in virtual reality right now. So they do have one of the highest pool of engineers in the world, and they are going full steam. And you can see that's their government 1 year anniversary video. So they are going really, really big time, and they have a lot of connection with Seattle and San Francisco, and their government is investing at the level or trillions of dollars. That's what Finland is doing. So they're going really big. So anyway, let's restart. I think some of you have seen that already, so let's not do it again. So let's say that Finland has a better view of this. They think they just don't want to advertise. They understand that it can be about doing stuff and basically just have a super great view. So that's the thing, you know, whatever. I've been working on movies, Avatar, things like that. I'm not going to show you my reel again, I don't care. But it's about 3D a lot. Education, stuff like that. So the goal of this presentation, I did it like already 2 years ago, no, a year and a half ago, at the beginning. I almost did that myself to try to understand. And I've also been teaching the history of cinema, and production of cinema, and cinematography, things like that. So I was trying to kind of make a parallel with what I was teaching over 2 years with kids, and on the side trying to do VR, because they all want to do movies, and I'm done with that, so that's kind of what. So I was trying to understand. So we're going to have an introduction after the evolution of cinema, interactivity, then after we're going to more dig maybe into what VR and AR can do, really. No, not what they can do, but what are actually just the paradox, the difference with cinema at least so far, on video games maybe. So while VR and AR, technically, it's the same stuff. It's just really a question of device. Because really, VR is really about having goggles, and AR is really having something that tracks space, but those are basically input. But the content itself is kind of the same. And I can tell you that on the movies I was working on, the content was really the same. We could have put a 360 camera right there, and it would have been already there. So it's really about changing the TV. Well, that, so yeah, I was putting that. So of course, you know, it's going on. Because like at the beginning, when we unite in 2016, there were tons and tons of news. Obama was in VR. He went to Yosemite to shoot something with a crew from Canada. And that's it. At the time, we were just, yeah, Woody said something amazing. The first cinematic challenge, I want to repeat it, just say right now in the world, there's people that love VR and people that haven't tried it. And that's it. So I think everyone loves it. So far, it's a 100% success. So, anyway, evolution of the cinema, because it's kind of the beginning of capturing and basically trying to directly like depict what we see with an eye, because basically a camera is an eye. So as I've been sharing with some of you, the human people haven't invented the camera. The camera is a biological thing. I guess some people have took an eye and slice it and they figured it out. So the camera obscura is a biological evolution. And the eye actually, if you don't know, come from the water, because basically if we can't see infrared, it's just because our eyes have been developed underwater, so we have fisheye basically. Mm-hmm. That's why we can't see a lot of spectrum of the light in the real world. So at the beginning there was Edison, then the Ringer Brothers, actually. The real guy that invented picture in movement is Edison, but he never really made the cinema with him. So George Méliès, David W. Griffiths on the concept of editing, and then after there were like even a much, much bigger push by the Russian, Hans-Sagan Eisenstein. So some of you have studied cinema this way, not everyone at least. So Thomas Edison, he did that. He created this machine, top right, which was basically a full loop film, and you could watch it like that just from a hole. And he created this thing that he called the Black Maya, which was the first first ever film studio on the planet Earth. Mm-hmm. And it was extremely smart because the guy was super smart. It was directly on an hinge and he could rotate it in function of the sun. So he had already made like a super clever studio stuff. And then it was the entrance like that, as shows, you know, in theater, stuff like that. So he had started to do that. But then the Lumière brothers, they did the same. I don't know actually if they had seen Petrie movement, but they must have, because they were show people. I don't know if you know, but they were like super loaded. Their father was extremely wealthy person, so they really had not to care about money. And they had factories, because their father was owning chemical factories, clothing factories, all that stuff. So actually, the camera, the first camera that you can see on top, right? It's called the cinematograph. People really consider that the Lumière brothers invented cinema because they actually didn't really invent the camera, but invented the projector. Because the first camera made by them, the cinematograph, was camera projector. Because you could put the film in there on record, then you would wind back, open the back, put a very strong light, and project back. And that's what they did, which was super smart. And they invented the business as well, because they were the first one to go in a show, rent a room, and make people clean tickets. So they invented the box office. So actually the first camera, to tell you, was out of their clothing factory. Do you know what how the first camera was made? It's two sewing machines. So one sewing machine that does clack clack, clack clack, clack clack to make the film move. So it's one mechanism that with a rolling system just make move something. Then another sewing machine doing that for the shutter. And by just linking both on rolling ducts, you just have two sewing machines doing the thing, and then you have a camera. So, sewing machine. So they think the first step was actually the workers leaving the Lumière factory. Another big famous stuff that they show was the arrival of the train, which really famously basically made people really jump out of the room at the first screen. And one of the men that actually was in this room was George Méliès, and he did not jump out of his seat. He was like, that's pretty cool. I'm gonna want to try to buy one of those. And they did not, so one to him. So he was like, fine. He went to London, he bought one from a London manufacturer a few years later. And then, so this guy, George Méliès, called himself Cinemagician. He was a magician, he was doing shows. He was just a guy that was doing shows. So for him, the camera was right away just a show thing. He was really just looking to be like, oh, okay, great. He tried to stun people every time, every day. And, Sunday thing, and they all jumped out of the room. So that's a thing. So let's do it. And then he did many crazy stuff, and then he invented the visual effects. So before any movie had been cut, narrated, sound, anything, visual effects were already going up. So he was doing magic stuff. And he discovered that with a kind of a lag in the machine, because the machine like jammed. So actually, the first ever cut made was just because the machine jammed. So he was rolling, it jammed, then he re-rolled. And then, looking at the film strip, it was jumping from an empty street to a street with a carriage. And he was like, that's an apparition, that's magic. Right. So let's do that. So the concept is that the cut then is a visual effect. It's an apparition. It's just saying, hey, that's nothing. So he did that a lot, and he did maths and many different things. So he was spending his time to indeed film and mat it with different cardboard or stuff, and then re-roll it and do the inverse mat and refilming itself. So he was doing super complicated stuff. So having multiple heads of him moving at the same time or things like that. Or he did many different things. He pretty much did everything. It's really insane how many things George Méliès did. He created like a theater as well that still exists in Lyon if you go visit it. He created like a sun house that with glass roof as well to basically be able to film in there. But the very very funny thing though is that he never ever moved the camera. The camera was there, dot. And even in the most famous shot he ever filmed, which is like the trip to the moon with the moon coming, the moon was coming to the camera. So it's because for George Méliès, the camera was a spectator sitting on a seat. And that's it.
Right.
and everything was on the stage. And that was it. So that's where basically cinema was. At
what year is that?
Oh, 1910 to 1930s, something like that. I don't know. Not remember. So yeah, the 1902. So as you can see, the VES, the Visual Effects Society, that is definitely like it's the same thing as the Actors Guild or everything, as the logo of the basically Trip to the Moon. it's George Méliès' Trip to the Moon. Then there were a guy called Edison Porter. So Edison at the time had a film studio, and one guy working for Edison was Edison Porter. So one thing actually. Do you know how really the first American studio really launched and how Edison made and gathered a lot of money at the beginning to film more stuff? By pirating Trip to the Moon and screening it illegal. So that's how it is. So the Trip to the Moon has been super copied and was basically screened everywhere in the world, like that. And then this guy was meant to be a director, and but he was more an editor, and then for the first time it did happen that they started to have a library of footage. And then Edison Porter ended up to be like, okay, let's try to mess around with that, and maybe to do stuff without actually going to film anything. So he really started to do real editing, and really edit stuff together. So Edison Porter was the first one, for example, to do reverse cuts, and to do a parallel editing. Like having one story, then another one, then one, then another one. So the Grand Train Robbery, 1903, was, let's say, some kind of the first narrative film, almost done. But it was still very badly cut. So for example, the cut in action would be wrong. So you would see a guy doing something from one thing, and then you would go to the third and seeing them doing it again, and then moving on. But then it was like not really cut in action, and not really cut, well. And then this guy came up, David W. Griffiths, who basically invented the real blockbuster as we know it, which is like a real theater piece, all that stuff. So this guy, yeah, he worked for Biograph, was looking to be an actor, then he ended up to be a director. He made 450 films, so a lot at the beginning. So for example, yeah, if you don't know, like the Lumière brothers, they shot over 1,000 roles. They never cut on any one of them. All of the roles were basically on, off, that's it. So that was the thing. People really did not consider to cut it at the beginning. It was really something weird. So David W. Griffiths is really the guy that did it all. He really messed it all. So he did the first cutting, meaning filming the same stuff with two different objects, like lens. And then after precisely cutting at the right moment for the people to just feel that they jumped in space, and that they have actually a more precise view of something. And then he created continuity editing, so indeed those concepts of really cutting right in action and having movement really going together, this kind of stuff, all the way to Birth of a Nation, who ended up to be very politically actually wrong in the US. It was kind of canceled and illegal, or I don't know, not illegal, but definitely banned in most of the states, because it was basically a KKK advertising.
No, no.
So the first greatest movie was for the KKK. Because basically, W. Griffith, he was not that much of a douche, but he was the son of a general, and he was just like, well, no, that's how it should be. So he was even super pissed when his movie was banned. So he wrote a pamphlet called The Rise and Fall of Free Speech in America. And he said, that's insane. It's like, how comes my movie is not screened and they don't like it? So he did write that. And then after that, he was like, they're still not really getting it. So, no, the pamphlet was not enough. So he made a movie called Intolerance, which was 8 or 9 hours long at the beginning, showcasing intolerance in 4 different epochs of humanity to really make his point. In different colors, all that stuff. So intolerance is, and so, and where was like the first blockbuster ever made. It became extremely famous. It was extremely well shot. It had the largest set ever built. And no one ever built bigger sets than that. They were destroyed, unfortunately. If you go at the Kodiaks, Kodak Theater, the one like at the Academy Awards, so basically you have all the stairs and you have like the big plaza in LA, and you have precisely those pillars with elephants. So basically the entrance of the Academy Awards Theater is the scene you look at it here. And at some point, they had over 15,000 extras. So David W. Griffiths was very serious about the thing. So for example, here you can see that people were really over there at the top, like that. And this shot was shot with a balloon.
Oh, no.
Say that again?
With a big balloon. Like a hot air balloon.
Yeah.
No, we have dropped. It did cost him $2.5 million. He did lose money. He died still paying interest.
Aww.
And the fact is, the Russians loved it. They loved intolerance. That was perfect. Intolerance was communism. That was wonderful. So the Russians created the Moscow Film School. And they were like, okay, let's get copy of intolerance, and we just have to do that for us. More intolerance, and that's it. So they created the Moscow Film School, and they really took the best scientists they had, and for them it was an academic purely research. So at the time, they had no money, no cameras, no film. So actually what they just did for a long, long period of time was just messing up with intolerance, to try to please the Moscow regime, and at the time it was like a Bolshevik regime going on. So they were starting to test real psychological effects. They were really starting to be like, okay, intolerance was super strong, but we absolutely have no real idea why, how. So they studied it. And so one of the guys is called Kuleshov. And Kuleshov created or find out what we call the Kuleshov effect. The Kuleshov effect is
took three shots and actors. In another experiment, Kuleshov took three shots and actor smiling, a close-up of a revolver, and the actor looking frightened. Shown to an audience, the interpretation was that the actor was growing cowardly. But reverse the order of the shots, and now the audience interprets the actor is growing brave. It's the exact same three shots, but the order changes the meaning. Though other filmmakers like D.W. Griffith had practiced this type of editing instinctively, Kuleshov was the first to put it into theory. The meaning of the film was not only in its spatial reality, how things are arranged in a frame, but in the film strip itself, the sequence of the shot.
Yeah. You get it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So there's basically this concept of hypnotic thing. And so for Hitchcock, that was what Hitchcock was calling pure cinema.
Now the third way is what one might call pure cinema, the assembly of film, and how it can be changed to create a different idea. And we have a close-up. Let me show you what. Let's assume we saw a woman holding a baby in her arms. Now we cut back to his reaction to what he sees. And he smiles. Now what is he as a character? He's a kindly man. He's sympathetic. Now, let's take the middle piece of film away, the woman with the child. But leave his two pieces of film as they were. Now we'll put in a piece of film of a girl in a bikini. He looks, girl in a bikini, he smiles.
Film can do for you. Basically, tripping people up by completely managing precisely how the short-term memory works emotionally and by messing up with that. So then after Sagan, you know, Shani wind up.